Okay, good morning, and thank you for joining me for Application Security Response When Hackers Come A-Knockin. This is the 20-minute Redux version, and we've got a lot of material to cover, so I'm going to lightly touch through a lot of topics here. Okay, so first of all, we'll go through some introductions, and then I will go through a tale of two different standards. One is covering vulnerability disclosure, and the other is covering the vulnerability handling processes, and that's all the processes inside of a vendor to do all of the investigation, the triage, the remediation, and the release of the eventual remediation or update. Okay. So, two standards for the best and worst of times. It's the best of times when a hacker comes and lets you know that there's a security vulnerability in one of your products or online services. The scope of these two standards is actually covering both what we would call traditional box products as well as online services. It may also even cover the scope of firmware that is in hardware. So the scope of these two standards, they're related, and I'll talk about how they're related exactly in the next couple of slides. But the scope is 29147 on vuln disclosure talks about how vendors should deal with vulnerability reports from external finders, aka hackers. And then 30111, which is the process internally for handling vulnerability reports and doing the investigation, it actually covers whether or not you receive the vulnerability report from an external finder or hacker, or if you receive that vulnerability report from one of your internal testing methodologies. So that actually covers how you're supposed to resolve all potential security vulnerabilities. So in either case, 30111 will apply. So this diagram actually shows the interconnectedness between these two standards. This diagram appears in both of the standards, and the point at which the hacker will come and knock in is in 29147. At that point, you'd go into the process internally for resolving the vulnerability in 30111, and we're going to walk through each of the phases for actually doing this investigation. So don't panic. And then, at the end, you'll release some sort of an update, an advisory, a bulletin that lets your users know how to tell if they're vulnerable, what to do about it, what the severity is, and everything's going to be all better. So let's go through, first we're going to go through 29147, which covers receiving the vulnerability report from the hackers, all of the things that you need to do to prepare to receive that report, and then the kinds of things that you need to release in terms of an advisory to advise your users of what to do when you've actually resolved the vulnerability. So first of all, make it easy for a hacker to find your front door. It's not always obvious. You know, there are a lot of support email addresses and whatnot. The standard actually gives some suggestions, doesn't say exactly what you're supposed to offer in terms of a front door or welcome mat for hackers, but it does give some suggestions such as secure at yourcompanyname.com or providing a web form. But essentially, if it's not obvious for somebody to report a vulnerability to you, they may come through other channels, and those other channels might not be a private vulnerability report to you. Those other channels might be something that you don't expect, such as going to the media. So, you've got the report. Now what do you do? Well, you need to acknowledge that you received it. This seems like a simple step. However, this is actually in the standard, and it is standardized of how much time you have as a vendor to acknowledge that you received it. This is different from acknowledging whether or not you actually believe it's a security vulnerability. This is just saying, I got your email. So, is auto-reply good enough for this purpose? Well, a lot of hackers actually spend a lot of time researching the vulnerabilities that they may report to you, so it doesn't actually make a lot of sense, you know, from my perspective, to reply with an auto-reply. You know, a real human is definitely going to start that relationship off on the right foot, and this is definitely what you want to set up if you're setting up a program like this. That being said, if you don't have the resources to actually do a reply in a timely manner, you know, an auto-reply might be okay as long as you can get a human to reply fairly quickly that you received the vulnerability report. So it's a good idea in your documentation on your website to actually ask for this type of information from the finders in a vulnerability report. I can guarantee you that if you don't get all of this information in the initial report, you are going to have to do some additional coordination. So ask for as much information up front as possible, as the hacker is willing to give you, and you'll be set up to do the investigation much more efficiently. Okay, so what should the actual advisory say? Don't worry, I'm just skipping to the advisory because remember, we're talking about 29147, which covers receiving the vuln report and then disseminating the advisory. We'll go back into 30111 into detail on how to investigate and resolve the vuln in just a minute. So what should the advisory say? This is an example advisory taken from one of the appendix of the standard itself. A lot of the companies who participated in making these standards lent their advisories as examples. So this is one. So here are some of the things that you should include in an advisory to make it useful. You'll have some unique identifiers. They're indicated by circles on the slides. There are a couple different kinds of unique identifiers, if you'll notice. There's one, which is a CVE, which is the unique identifier for the vulnerability itself. There's also another, in terms of the vendor's own, unique identifier for this advisory notice. There will be other unique identifiers that you'll use inside of the vulnerability resolution process, of course, such as internal case numbers and whatnot. But the point is, here in the advisory, you need your users to be able to differentiate one vulnerability from another. And also, to be able to differentiate one notice about a vulnerability from another. You may actually have to revise the notice about this vulnerability, so it's a good idea to have that uniqueness in the advisory notices. The meat of the advisory itself should contain enough information for a user to determine their risk level. So it should contain enough detail such that a user can figure out, well, am I at risk? What programs, what platforms are affected, what online services are affected? So that's what's underlined there in pink, Active Directory on Microsoft Windows 2000 server. It also should let users know what an attacker could do if they're successful. So that's this last line here, where saying, you know, an attacker who successfully exploits this vuln could take complete control. This actually allows a user to tell, one, if they're affected, and two, what's the worst that could happen. The last thing that you should include in an advisory, and it's not included in this one because, you know, as you know, Microsoft has its own update channel, but the last thing you as a vendor should include in your advisory is where can the user actually download the fix or read the documentation to be able to make the appropriate changes. So that's the other bit in this advisory. Okay, so in summary of 29147, before we go into the process standard, vendors should have a clear way to receive vulnerability reports. Make it easy on the hackers to come to you if they have done some work and done some research to find a vulnerability in your product or online service. You should acknowledge the report within 7 calendar days. That is the only time limit that is designated in either of these standards. There are no other time limits that are set by the standards. So 7 calendar days to acknowledge just that you received the report, not that you've done all the investigation, et cetera. Vendors should coordinate with finders. We'll go into that in more detail in the process, the internal process, but as you hit snags in the investigation, you really are going to have to communicate with those finders in order to properly investigate the case. And then vendors should issue advisories with a minimum of the following information: some unique identifier, the affected products as you know it, the impact or the severity of the issue, and then how to eliminate or mitigate. And it's generally a good idea to give the finders credit, give those hackers credit in the advisory when you release it, if they choose to reveal their names. So they do appreciate it. Okay, I didn't skip all the good parts. We're going to go back into it. So how do you investigate and remediate these issues? These are all the internal processes, again, as I said, so don't panic. All right, so let's try and summarize it up front, and then I'll go through the exact phases. So first, vendors should have some kind of a process. This, in fact, if you think about it, all vendors should have some kind of a general bug remediation process, some kind of general bug prioritization process. This is sort of an extension of that if you think about it. You need to have an organizational structure that will support specific types of vulnerability resolution, which may occur in very dynamic timelines, balancing a bunch of risk factors, and it's not necessarily going to fit into your regular product development cycle, even if you're an agile house. So you do need to have some additional support structures in your organization to be able to do this properly. Vendors should perform root cause analysis. This does seem like a pretty obvious statement, but in my years as a vulnerability coordinator and working as a vendor, I've coordinated vulnerabilities across hundreds of different organizations. And quite frankly, we've had the experience where you've provided proof of concept, and the vendor in question has only patched that one vector or that one proof of concept, or even in the worst case, if the proof of concept pop calculator, they just uninstalled calc on everything and thought they were fine. So, it can be, it can vary in terms of the depth of root cause analysis that you see across vendors. Hopefully, what this standard will do will give a lot of vendors sort of a baseline to know what that means in terms of root cause analysis. So we'll go through that. Vendors should weigh the various remediation options to adjust for real-world risk. It's ideal that you go through all of the investigation steps and be extremely thorough. However, if your users are actually under active attack, you may have to put out a temporary mitigation and then revisit and put out the complete solution a little bit later. So you really do need to balance speed with thoroughness, and you also need to make sure that the update that you create doesn't introduce additional problems. Not just additional app compatibility issues, which is a huge problem, but also, sometimes it could possibly introduce other security issues that you didn't see. So the last bit here that we'll talk about is that vendors should try to coordinate with other vendors whenever appropriate. So we'll give some examples of multi-vendor issues, supply chain issues that will require vendors to coordinate with each other. Okay, so these are the phases of 30111, and this is the process. So first of all, we'll talk about you receive the vulnerability report. If it was from an external finder, that came in via the channel that was defined by the other standard, 29147. If it came from an internal find, the process will be similar, but your risk factors may be a little bit different. So understand the communication expectations to the hackers as you're going through this process, if it did come from the outside. Okay, so verification. These steps may occur in parallel, they may occur sequentially, but essentially all of these steps occur somewhere in the verification phase. In the initial investigation, that's where you just make a decision whether or not, essentially, that this is actually something that warrants further investigation. You may decide that, yes, it's a bug, but I'm still not sure whether or not it has security implications. I'm going to open a case on it anyway, et cetera. So that's the initial investigation. You don't have to make all of the triage decisions there. Once you actually do figure out that it is indeed a vulnerability, you'll do this root cause analysis. So you attempt to find the underlying cause of the vulnerability, and then that spawns further investigation. The further investigation part is where you actually attempt, once you've identified root cause, you attempt to find that same vulnerability across across other instances of your products, your online services, et cetera. The amount of time that you have to do this investigation will vary, and obviously will vary based on the real-world threats and risks. Prioritization, you are going to have to consider the threat posed by the vulnerability itself on all of your product lines or all of your online services. And not all of your products on all of your platforms, if you're doing traditional box products, will have the same severity rating. So you might have newer products that the issue ends up only being a denial of service, whereas your older products, maybe the issue causes a condition in which you can execute remote code execution. So prioritization across different product lines and fixes may be different. There are possible exit conditions that could occur during this phase. So when you're in the verification phase, if you can't repro the vulnerability, again, this is a place where you would coordinate out with the finder and ask for more information. If you asked for all of that information up front, well, you're in probably good shape. But if you can't repro the issue, even with all of that information, definitely don't close the case before touching base with that external finder if it did come from them. If it's a duplicate bug and you've already fixed it or you're going to fix it, you would exit the process then. If it's a bug in an obsolete product that's not under support, you would exit at that point as well. Again, communication with the finder is key, and if you can set those expectations up front of which products are under support or not, that actually helps the relationship quite a bit. If it's a non-security bug, Now, this determination is going to be pretty subjective, and it may have to be revisited. There may be a security bug technically, but there's no way that you can see to exploit it with current exploitation technology. As a vendor, to make this determination, you really do have to keep up with exploit science as it is, cutting edge, because what may not have been exploitable yesterday may be exploitable tomorrow. And then finally, if it's a third-party bug, you'll have to coordinate with other vendors. You then, if you do an investigation, it turns out it's an underlying component that belongs to a different vendor, then you then may turn out to be the coordinator in this case. So resolution development. You make a decision about a resolution. As I said, you're balancing the time that it takes to build a quality resolution and do the testing that you need and the risk to your users. Once you produce that remediation, obviously as a vendor, you're under obligation to do some appropriate level of testing. Again, this is going to be very dynamic and based on the current risk environment for that particular vulnerability. Finally, this is the release phase, and this is where the process forks a little bit. If it's an issue in an online service, then follow your own organization's, you know, deployment rollout in order to deploy the fix or the upgrade or the configuration change on your own systems. If it is in a box product where you need your users to take some kind of action, then you would release an advisory and then instruct them to take whatever action that is, if it's a configuration change or applying a patch. So after release, there's some maintenance issues that you need to do. You need to track whether or not that remediation actually worked, right? And you also need to feed this information back into your security development lifecycle. There's another standard that covers secure development, application security, secure development, and that's 27034. When you do the root cause analysis in 30111, feeding that information back into your SDL is what is going to allow you to get better over time and prevent similar vulnerabilities in the future. And then you go ahead and monitor the effectiveness of the remediation that you've put out. Okay, so what to say and when to say it. Communicate with the external finders. We've talked about that. Make sure your communication channels are secure. There's some secure way to exchange vulnerability information. Convey any kind of timeline slips with them promptly so that that keeps that relationship open and transparent. Communicate internally with your product business divisions. It's a good idea as you're setting up these processes, and as I talked about organizational framework to support, that you establish SLAs within your own organization of how quickly product teams may have to get back to your internal security teams about whether or not, you know, X product is affected, Y product is affected. So all of that repro investigation steps, you really should have an SLA in place. And then communicate with coordinators and other vendors. You know, there could be multi-vendor issues, and we'll talk about that in a second. And then, of course, communication externally with the affected users by releasing the advisories. So other process considerations. Monitor the process itself. So take a look, benchmark your process. Take a look at how long it takes for you to investigate and resolve security vulnerabilities. You know, it's a good idea as well if you're rolling out this process internally over time, if you have different business units, benchmark them against each other and see how that helps improve the process over time, at least against each other. And then monitor for completeness. You know, how many times do you have to reissue a patch or an update because it actually didn't completely resolve the issue? So that's a way to improve feedback in, improve your process, and do root cause analysis. So confidentiality of the vulnerability information is really important as well. So there's two kinds of things to keep confidential. Any PII that may have been associated with a vuln report, maybe the finder came in and gave you a database dump of all of your user social security numbers. So you've got to keep that information secured, and you also need to keep the finder's information secured if they've actually asked you to keep their own information private. And then, of course, the details of the vuln itself. That's the obvious thing that everybody needs to protect in terms of protecting the confidentiality of this. Premature disclosure of any of this information before you've had a chance to even complete your investigation can cause more harm than good. Supply chain and multi-vendor. I promise to touch on this briefly. So if the vuln is a part of another vendor's supply chain, say it's in a library or it actually was in a functional specification and it turns out to be a multi-vendor issue, there are a lot of messy things and interconnectedness that you may have to negotiate. It's a good idea to get to know the security teams at other companies, especially other companies, other vendors who are in your software supply chain. Get to know them, establish a process for communication and escalation before you actually are in an emergency situation. So it's not if, but when. When are these standards coming out? Well, there are 9 stages of ISO publication, et cetera. And likely by end of 2013 is when these standards will be published in live. So this is actually coming up, and it's quite timely. So how do I think these standards will actually affect vulnerability handling? Well, I expect that 29147 will make it a lot easier for hackers to come A-Knockin and have a consistent way to expect to deal with vendors. I hope it will also make vendors vendors' advisories more useful and more interesting for users to be able to assess their risk and apply the appropriate remediation. And then how will 30111 help the world? Well, hoping it's going to actually raise that baseline level of security investigation and improve the coordination between different vendors. Okay, so that is all, and I will thank you very, very much for your time. If you want to find me, I am Katie Moe on Twitter if you have any other questions. Thank you so much.